Welcome to the program Face of Mercy. As you know, in the past episode, we have been dealing with the women characters in the Old Testament and what they do and what they did. And beyond that, what they did, it was try to understand God's mercy manifested. Now, for today, we come to another character. And for this, we have with us Reverend Dr. Michael Kyrie-Mettum, a renowned Bible scholar and a scripture professor. And Father, we are so delighted to have you with us today, as we have been always.
Thank you.
And for today, we have another character. The name is not mentioned, but we have, you know, put it the other way, Jephthah's daughter. In fact, you also Shunammite woman, you know, some names are that way. Now, the context, as most of us would know, you know, Jephthah is coming victoriously. You know, so he has made a promise to the Lord. And he's caught by his own promise or the oath. He tells the Lord, you know, when I come victoriously, whoever comes out of the house, I will sacrifice that, or whatever be that. And very shockingly, what happens is that when he comes, his own daughter comes out first. And here is a conflict, actually, where he should strictly follow the oath and sacrifice her. And what is her plight? At the same time, does God want him to kill or do the sacrifice? And at the same time, you know, what about the oath that he has taken? And what's the message, actually? That is more confusing. Okay, incidents can happen. Maybe there is a lot of plot and whatnot. Many things could be there that we can understand. But why such stories in the Bible? That's one question. In what way does it bring any inspiration, or Mother, elevates you into the, you know, the intimacy with God? Or maybe in the right in the context of our daily life, how do we understand God's mercy when things happen the other way?
Yeah, Babu, this person, I think, is not very, very popular, not much known among the people, the Jephthah and the Jephthah's daughter. It's a very interesting character, another very cruel picture. You have said the essentials, but I think it is better to read the text dealing with the sacrifice of the daughter of Jephthah. That is in chapter 11 of the book of Judges, verses 34 to 40, the end of the chapter.
Then Jephthah came to his home at Mizpah, and there was his daughter coming out to meet him with the timbrels and with dancing. She was his only child. He had no son or daughter except her. When he saw her, he tore his clothes and said, "Alas, my daughter, you have brought me very low. You have become the cause of great trouble to me, for I have opened my mouth to the Lord, and I cannot take back my vow." She said to him, "My father, if you have opened your mouth to the Lord, do to me according to what has gone out of your mouth. Now that the Lord has given you vengeance against your enemies, the Ammonites." And she said to her father, "Let this thing be done for me. Grant me 2 months, so that I may go and wander on the mountains and bewail my virginity, my companions and I." "Go," he said, "and send her away for 2 months." So she departed, she and her companions, and bewailed her virginity on the mountains. At the end of 2 months, she returned to her father, who did with her according to the vow he had made. She had never slept with a man, so there arose an Israelite custom that four days every year, the daughters of Israel would go out to lament the daughter of Jephthah the Gileadite.
Very interesting, intriguing
thing. Yes.
And I think we have many things to ponder here. First, we have two characters here.
Yes.
A male character, a female
character.
We are trying to see God's face of mercy expressed through women in the Bible. Because we have a tendency to say God is man, God's, because father, son, or a male figure. And somehow the female figure is considered as secondary, etc. So exactly that what we are trying to point out. How the compassionate face of God is reflected in the women. Characters in the Bible. The first reading, we may not see it as we saw in the question of Rahab or for the Jael, etc. Now here comes another woman character. The daughter, she has no name and she has done no wrong, nothing wrong. And she is ready to sacrifice her life only to save the father's vow. Now, there are several questions that come to mind. What is the vow? And what was he right to do that vow? And was he obliged to keep that vow? So that will come later. And the attitude of the girl. She tells the father, well, if you have made a vow, please do it. And she knew it was sacrifice. Then comes the question, are you allowed to sacrifice? Does God demand a human sacrifice? Is God a cannibal? As many think. So human sacrifice, is Bible encouraging human sacrifice or discouraging it? What is it? And then the question of bewailing the virginity. What is? Now, you come to the point, ask. I'll come to Jephthah a bit later.
Yeah.
Can you tell me why is Jephthah so much worried, so much bothered? What is he crying about?
I would believe because in this context, as we understand the human way of understanding, of course, he made the vow inadvertently, and she could have never expected the daughter to come out. And if she sacrificed perhaps the human feeling, no other daughter.
First of all, he doesn't think that his daughter will come.
Yeah, that's true.
That's one thing. So he was ready to sacrifice anybody except his daughter. So he doesn't care who comes. He wants to win the battle. And you know, in order to force the hand of God, I am ready to give him anything, even including a human sacrifice. That doesn't cost me anything.
Yes.
That's one thing. Second, when he sees that his daughter comes, you know why he is crying? You are my only daughter. And so what? It means that I will not be having a progeny that continues.
Yeah, yeah.
So according to that time, the belief was, you continue your existence through your children. So if you die without children, you are lost forever. So he's not crying for his daughter, he's crying for himself. So because you are my only daughter and I am going to kill you, then I live without anything. So there was no question of resurrection there. They did not know anything about the afterlife. The father lives through the son, not through the daughter. So that's a male dominance. So this is how he understood. And now he says, my God, not because I have to kill you, but because I have to die without another child who continue my... See the egoistic understanding of Jephthah and the totally other...
Then the daughter
says, father, okay, well and good. Go ahead. But she is bewailing the virginity. Why? Not because she did not have the pleasure of having sex with a man. He is bewailing, but she could not give a son to his father for him to continue. See how the altruistic is the thought of the daughter. You see the contrast between the man and the woman. The father who is crying because he doesn't have a child who will perpetuate his name.
Yeah.
And the daughter is crying because she did not succeed in giving a son to perpetuate the name of his father. The father is totally self-centered attitude and the daughter is totally altruistic attitude. See the contrast. And who is better, the man or the woman?
The woman is.
And who represents God's compassion, God's love? Here see the woman. See, very often we see the Bible is anti-feminine. But go to the heart of the reading. What is it? So now it would seem the whole blame is on Jephthah. And she goes on and he allows, okay. He's not happy, but at the same time he has to do it. So that is the first part. The daughter allowing her father to perform the vow. But then she wants to spend some time to reflect, to pray. Not to procreate a child, but to lament that she could not bring a child forth to perpetuate the name of his father. So that's why she lamented her virginity. Not that she did not have sex, but she could not give a son. That is the trouble also with Rachel. So every woman wanted to have a child so that the name of the father will continue. You see with Judah and Tamar. The Tamar wanted to have a son. So that Judas. So this is how the women consider. Even though we are only made use of as an object, we participate in this and we take this care, the concern to continue the life. And that's what Adam said. She will be called Hawa. Yeah. Eve means the mother of all. So when you contrast the male and the female characters, of course, both have their own. Now we come to Jephthah. I had a question. Was Jephthah bound to kill the daughter? This is a question. The same thing happened in the New Testament. You know, Herod, Antipas.
Yeah. Yes.
Celebrating his birthday. And Herodias was a cunning woman who wanted to kill John the Baptist. And unfortunately, this stupid Herod made a vow. So whatever you ask,
he'll give.
Even half my kingdom I shall give to you, to the daughter. And she wanted the head of John the Baptist. So the questions are similar. Was Herod, Herod Antipas bound to kill John the Baptist? Was he allowed? Did he have the right to? The same way, did Jephthah have to perform that vow? Or did he have the right to do that?
It's a very conflicting situation.
So the conflict is between performing a vow?
Yeah. But that vow, if it is by erroneous decision.
So now the question is, did he have the right to make that vow? First of all. Second, did God want such a vow? Why did he do that? He was already chosen and he has been given enough signs. Still, he wanted to make sure that God will help. Lack of faith. Why do you make a vow, in fact? I see people making so many vows in retreat centers, and I shall do that and I shall do this. To whom are you making this vow? Why are you making this vow? Do you want to somehow force the hand of God to do something? Is your God such a reluctant figure who doesn't want to give you something? So you have to twist his hand by your vow? I think, first of all, the vow itself is a sign of lack of confidence in God. It's not the God the Father whom Jesus presented to us. Your Father knows exactly what you need before you ask. So why are you so much afraid? Why do you want to swing the hand? To force God's hand? You cannot do that. So by making such a vow, you are expressing your own lack of trust in God. First thing. Second, do you have the right to kill somebody? What right did this Jephthah have to make such a vow? Did God ever want? First of all, we did not ask him. And second, he had no right. You shall not kill. The commandment was there through Moses. So first of all, he did not have to make a vow. Second, he had not had the right to make a vow. And third, he was totally unjustified to killing a person. Third. But now, who is this Jephthah? That's one thing. So before I condemn Jephthah, I had to ask, who is he? What was his life?
Basically, Father, when you say that, it comes to the fact that they are not sure of the nature of God.
That's one thing. Now, making all these vows, I don't think it is needed. You make a promise. I shall burn 10 candles if I get this thing. Are you making a bargain?
You're bargaining, yeah.
Are you making a business? Just as somebody has gotten today, a lady came and said, Father, I need a prayer. For what? Yeah, my son studied medicine in America and now he is not getting a visa. I should pray for that. Okay, I shall pray. What do you need? And you are paying. If you, something like margain, the offering, sacrifice, as God is demanding, the greater the favor you want to receive, the costlier the offering you make. So is religion a bargaining thing? It's a business. God doesn't want to make religion a business. First of all, trust that God is your Father who loves you more, even more than your son, his own son. He loved us so much that he gave his only son to the cross. And he did not cry, he did not come down when he cried, my God, why have you forsaken me? God did not come. Jesus prayed in such an anguish, agony. Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup, pass away from me. Make this cup pass away. He did not. So this is a God, the Father, whom you believe. It's not a petty king who demands something like, What God wants is not your offering, yourself, not what I have. God wants you, your heart, your total submission. That you cannot do by giving something. So all this could be something. Now we're coming back to Jephthah. Please read chapter 11.
Now Jephthah, the Gileadite, the son of a prostitute, was a mighty warrior, and Gilead was the father of Jephthah. Gilead's wife also bore him sons, and when his wife's son grew up, they drove Jephthah away, saying to him, "You shall not inherit anything in our father's house, for you are the son of another woman." Then Jephthah fled from his brothers and lived in the land of Tob. Outlaws collected around Jephthah and went raiding with him.
So, this is the background.
Yeah.
So before you judge a person and his actions, you should know who he is. Why did Jephthah behave like this? Because that was the background. He was born out of wedlock. And then he had a father. But then this father had sons by the legal wife. So they are brothers. But the legal sons considers him as a foreigner, as a bastard. So that's how he felt. He was considered as a fatherless, as an orphan, as a bastard, hated, rejected, ridiculed, and he goes on, chased out of the house. So you can see the wound somehow inflicted on his childhood heart. And now he grows up. He grows up as a thug, as a terrorist, as a bandit group leader. So that's how he grows up. So before he comes as the leadership, this is the experience he had. So this person, first of all, he has his inferiority complex because he doesn't have a legal family. Then he was hated by his brothers as an outlaw. And as such, he considers himself as a sinner. Even God will not protect him. Then he says, the people of Israel come. Then he says, "So I should be your leader if you take." So they allowed him to be. So keeping this in background, when he comes, he's always afraid, will God protect me? Will God accept me? This is my background. I'm a bastard, I am a terrorist, I am a bandit. Will God allow me? Okay, I try to. So I give the best I can. So we cannot blame Jephthah for what he did, because his knowledge of God was so little. If there was a God who is so compassionate and loving, why did he allow me to be chased out of my family? That is how he thinks. So he has a false concept of God. A false concept that is somehow imprinted on his heart by the nature, by the situation. So I think this has also been taken into account. The way you deal with people, as a brother, as a father, as whatever, the way, especially with children, can impress on their hearts some very wrong concepts about God. If a person doesn't believe in God, or if a person doesn't believe in a just and merciful God, maybe because of the childhood.
Yeah, child experience.
If a child has experienced only brutality in his home, a father who is a drunkard, a mother who is not faithful, who doesn't care for the children, and somehow this child is allowed to grow, and then from both sides, he doesn't have a true picture of God. How does a person get the image of God? It's not somehow imprinted in the heart. Mm-hmm. You learn it from outside. You see how your father, so when I speak of my father, God as father, the image of my father comes into my mind. And if my father was a drunkard and a cruel person, then that's how I think about God. The same thing with the mother. But if I had a father who is gentle, polite, caring, then I can, it's much easier to say
to
about my father. The same with mother. When I speak about my mother, God as mother, I see my mother in my front. A mother who had been always there. Just one example. It was in 2004, I think. 2004, 2005. I had an operation here in 2000, and then it was all healed. I went to a program in Shalom, we had for the Christmas program. And then at the end, so I had 4 or 5 episodes. And then the director, the producer told, Father, can you say the Mass? You have not said the Mass. Okay, I can say the Mass. So it took us a long time. And that night, when I came back, I had such a severe headache. I slept for some time. Then I got up. I could not sleep anymore. I had so severe problem. Then mother was there. Mother was something 90 at that time. She came and sat beside me. Then I slept. Everything was okay. Around 4 o'clock in the morning, I wake up and see my mother sitting at, a woman of 87 years old, sitting at 4 o'clock by my bed. That is mother.
Yes.
So when I speak of God as mother, this is
that's,
what.
Yeah,
it's true. It's the same thing in the father. No? So what do you experience? That makes you, whatever you learn from book or person, what you have experienced, that will somehow strike you. So coming back to Jephthah. Jephthah had a father who didn't care for him. And Jephthah had a mother who did not own him. And who else? Then he speaks of God. So maybe he tried to impress, tried to influence God by doing this and that. And so this was, he didn't consider as a crime to sacrifice. It seems human sacrifice was common. In the Bible, we have many other instances. Yes. Much later, the king's sacrificing his own son. So this is, we have to take into account. Don't be judgmental, I would say. Jesus said, don't judge you also. So don't judge Jephthah for his, because if you know what he had been through, why he did that. And now this person is such a difficult situation. I have made a vow to God. At the same time, here is my only daughter. What should I do? He could have said no. To God, I cannot say no. So rather sacrifice my only daughter than say no to God. Only that, this was a false understanding. A religiosity that made him a murderer. He's not guilty, but the ideology that has been fed into him, and that can happen even today. A religion that paints a picture of God so demanding. That is wrong. And even today you make vows, and very often we make vows. To whom? Why do you make this vow? Why do you make this vow? So I think we need to go deeper into the event and also the character before you judge a person. So this is such a complicated thing, but when you come, both are right in their own way. And the Bible is telling us, don't create such situations. Don't make such vows. Herod did not have the power to make a vow like that. He did not have it. I'd have no authority over the life of a person. Don't make a vow that is beyond your capacity. After all, why should you make a vow at all? Do what you have to. And God is not waiting for your vow. God is waiting for your love. And that we have to keep in mind.
Thank you, Father. You know why? Because this is a particular subject that needs to be understood well, because it applies to practically everyone. And particularly in the context of, as we discussed about Jephthah and the daughter, perhaps we tend to misunderstand Jephthah. Of course, egoistic, as you said, his concern was that. But as in, compared to, when you take the women, that is daughter, she said the face of God, so altruistic, that concern. A very, very lovable picture of God as a father. At the same time, as you mentioned, it becomes very clear for all of us that can we judge Jephthah? Of course, he made a mistake, or rather, what would be the fact that he wanted to please God and therefore demand, force God's hand into the situation, therefore make sure that, to have a certainty. But at the same time, that certainty was coming upon him because of the background, because the way he came, the experience that he had, made him so. Therefore, when we understand that, you know, we cannot judge. And that's a wonderful lesson, Father, that we have learned from this particular character, particularly the women character, the God's mercy manifested, and Jephthah, what he did, or rather what he failed to do in both manner. Thank you for being with us for this episode. I'm sure this episode has enlightened you much. And we come to the particular point, of course, God's mercy, never to be misunderstood, rather to be very certain that God is merciful and trusting in God's love and his nature. And the uncertainty can cause you know, as Jephthah did, go into certain certainty that we want to have by making promises that is not wanted. God wants you and all that you need to love Him. Thank you for being with us for this episode. Stay blessed. Thank you so much. Thank you, Father. Thank you so much. Thank you.